Hey there, everybody. My name is Andrew, and it is so good to be with you. Now, I want to let you guys know about some amazing things that we have coming up. But before I get to what those things are, I just want to take a quick step backwards, just for a sec. You know, we always have a lot of things going on, and we want to make sure that you know what those things are and all the relevant information about it. You know, what time is it? Where is it? How much does it cost, if anything? You know, all that good stuff. And it's always our goal to have clear and consistent lines of communication so that everybody knows what is going on so you don't miss out, because we certainly do not want that at all. You probably know what a few of those lines of communication are. For example, one of those is the video that you are watching right now. So check that one off. You know, we also put a lot of information on our church website and on our church's Facebook page. If you attend in person, you have probably picked up a bulletin of some kind that also has lots of information in there. And if you ever have any questions about anything, feel free to reach out at the church office during the week so that we can get you that information. Now, back to that church website kind of thing. I want to show you something really cool that will help you keep up with all the things that we have going on. All right, let me show you how simple it is to use our church website to see what is coming up on the calendar. Now, the first thing you're gonna need to do is open up your browser and go to ibcsav.com. Wait for that to load, should be pretty quick. This is what the church website looks like if you haven't checked that out. Actually, let me put one thing in here. If you're a guest with us today, we are super glad that you are here. All you need to do is click here to connect up here at the top. But for upcoming events, all you have to do is click on this events tab and it will pull up the calendar. Now up here at the top, we have some upcoming featured events. Things that I personally am very excited about. We've got a dessert auction and lunch coming up on Sunday, January the 31st. It's only $6 a person, and then the dessert auction will happen after that, and all the funds raised are going to go to support student ministry trips and events this year. Then you'll see our tournament party, which is has to do with Super Bowl. That's on Sunday, February the 7th at 6 p.m. And if you need more information about that, all you have to do is click right here and it'll pull up everything that you need to know. Then let's go to the end of the month. February 27th is a church-wide yard sale. Now, we hope that you guys might be getting prepared for that, but if you need information, all you have to do is click on this. And then, jumping ahead to the end of March even, information about our Boston Butt fundraiser that unfortunately we weren't able to do last year, but we will be able to do this year. So those are upcoming featured events, and then when you scroll down, you will actually see a real deal legit calendar that you can scroll through week by week, month by month, to see what is coming up so that you don't miss out. And I know what you might be thinking, all right, what if I do it on my phone? Once again, it could be simpler. Just go to your phone, open up your web browser, go to ibcsav.com. You click on the little hamburger icon here up at the top, pulling down a list of options to choose from, not that one. And then you click on events. You can click on calendar right here. And once again, it'll pull up with just the same information, beginning with upcoming featured events that we just talked about. You can scroll down right here to see each one of those. And if you click on one, it'll give you more information. And then right there is the same calendar. All right, it really couldn't be simpler. You guys are well on your way to understanding how to use this amazing tool to keep up with some great things that we have coming up for you. Now, in today's worship service, we are glad to welcome a guest trumpeter with us today. So without further ado, we're gonna get that started. All right, I got my trumpet right here. You know, I played this in middle school band, so I think I am fully 100% prepared to do what needs to be done today. All right, are you guys ready with me? Here we go.
And I did actually hear him practicing a little bit this week. It wasn't too bad. So middle school band, go. Woohoo. Good job, Andrew. Let's stand together and let's join our voices in song as we begin our worship today. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Let's sing that out this morning.
highest power we trust in His love. Great is the Lord, He is faithful and true, by His mercy He proves He is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice. Now lift up your voice. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord. Great is the Lord, He is holy and just. By His power we trust in His love. Great is the Lord, He is faithful and true. By His mercy He proves He is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the Lord and worthy of praise. Great is the Lord, now lift up your voice. Now lift up your voice.
Seated. Pastor Lane?
Yes, good to see each one of you here this morning. Just want to say a word of welcome to everyone who's in attendance here, and if you're watching online. In fact, if you're watching online and you just got here with us, you see that things are a little bit different up here on the stage just because we have something very extra special going on this morning. Got Kevin Harry here, and he's going to say a little bit about himself. I mean, he's going to introduce himself in a little bit, so just going to let him take care of that. But just want to say welcome to him. Welcome to you. Thank you for being a part of our worship service this morning. I believe we're in for a great, great treat. So let's go to God in prayer this morning. God, we thank you for our time together, for the chance that we have to come together once again to receive strength from one another, to encourage one another, and to lift up your name. And I pray that we could do that this morning as you deserve. God, inspire us to live for you this week and to be a light in a lost and dark world. And Lord, I do pray if there's anyone in the sound of my voice, anyone who is here, anybody who is watching a recording on the computer or on their phone, wherever, if they don't know you, Lord, I pray that you'd use what happens here today to bring them closer and closer to you, to the point where they come to recognize their need for you and they call upon you as Savior and as Lord. And Lord, we thank you that you are still a God who saves, and we count on that, and we worship you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord above all, you are creator and we stand in awe at the works of your hand, the ways of your heart. This is the cry of your people. This is the cry of your people. Come Holy Spirit, rain down your mercy. Lord, we have come here to worship. Lord, we have come here to worship.
majestic is your holy name. Won't you come and bless us once again? This is the cry of your people. Come, Holy Spirit, bring down your mercy. Lord, we have come here to worship. This is your temple. We are your people. On the front, she's running sound and pushing all those buttons for us. We have been married for 6 years. This coming September will be 7 years. We have 6 children. I'm going to give you just a second to do the math. She was not pregnant for 6 years in a row, I promise. We are a blended family. She had 4, and I had 2 when we met. We have everything from ages 14 to 26. They're everywhere from Mobile to Dallas, to Carrollton, to Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Our almost youngest son is on track at the University of Alabama, so he is out there doing all that. We have one that's in military, we have one that's married, and 2 getting married this year. So we have a busy year coming up. So I've been singing all my life. My parents stood me on a communion table when I was 2 years old. Now, I don't remember that, but that's how the story goes. And my mother handed me a microphone and said, "Kevin, sing." Well, those of you with children, you know that's dangerous to hand a 2-year-old a live microphone and tell him to sing. I have a little clip of what I sang for him that morning. Would you like to hear it?
Like a rhinestone cowboy.
Man, that's a true story. Hand to God. And I guess that's why I've started wearing these clothes. Everybody tells me I look like Glenn Campbell a little bit. And maybe, so when I was young, maybe that was a prediction of how things were. My mom said, "No, don't sing that. Do something else." So I sang a little Hank Williams for him. That's what we listened to growing up. I originally got around to doing the song she wanted me to do, and I still do it today. I do it a little different. I play some. So if you recognize the song, if you'd like to sing along, you feel free.
Thank you.
tells me so.
Inside my lips, and if you've ever played brasses, you know, that makes it a little difficult. So I looked around this morning at the hymnals and just tried to see what kind of music you do. I sang in a church last Sunday, and they had the red back church hymnals laying on the pew, and I thought they're going to run me out of here if I get too edgy on them. But, you know, to me, and Brother Mark and I were talking this morning, a good song is a good song. Would you agree with that? If it's got good lyrics, if it's solid theology in the lyrics, if it talks about Bible, then it's a good song. There was a song that came out, and I did church music for 17 years, and I love to know the stories behind the songs and why they were written and maybe what that songwriter was going through when they wrote and how God worked in their lives. And I found this song, and there were a few statements that had been made about it, and I want to share those with you. One of the statements was, this is a passing fad. It'll never last. Another statement was, this is only for the youth. It won't last. And another statement went so far as to say, this is of the devil and has no place in the church. I'm nervous about it, but I want to sing that song for you. Actually, I'm going to play a little bit of it first, and then I'll sing some of it. A good song, keep that in mind, a good song is a good song. But somebody thought that this was bad and it was of the devil. You take a listen and you see if you agree with those folks.
Oh, but now I clearly see.
glad that it was not a passing fad. Amen. It was just new. When Martin Luther introduced hymn singing to the church, it was new, and it allowed folks like me and you to sing the songs, and it was a change, and folks didn't like it. I do want to do a song for you now that's new. The first time I sang this way back in the 90s when it came out, I was on church staff, and the pastor said, "You're not allowed to sing that song here anymore." It's a good song, and it has strong lyrics, and you listen to the message in this song.
His success wasn't leaving and finding.
give us something to think about. Now, I look around at what's going on in our world, and they say, this is the right thing to do, when you know in your heart it's not. Amen? I think maybe the devil tried to shut this message down. And what I wanted to share with you this morning, you hear my voice going too. I'm not sure what's up with that, but the devil loves to mess with things. But the Bible says we are more than conquerors. Amen? Anybody believe that? We're more than conquerors in Jesus Christ. Amen. The Bible says ask, seek, and knock. Amen. I love where it says keep on asking. Keep on knocking. Keep on seeking. God still has things he wants to pour out in our lives today. Do you believe that? Amen. Amen. I see you folks sitting up on the shelf. You believe that too? You believe we're more than conquerors? Amen. I want to do a song now for you. It talks about the blood of Jesus and that sacrifice that was made. And I think about all that he went through. And I think about when we're tired and we don't want to get up and go to church. And I think about when Jesus was carrying that cross and he said, you know what, I'm tired today. I just don't want to do this anymore. And when they beat him, the Bible says they plucked his beard from his face and shoved a crown of thorns on his head. He could have said, I don't want to do this anymore. They're not worth it. I'm tired. I don't feel like it. But he chose the cross for us today. And the Bible says that his blood, that sacrifice, was enough once and for all time. Amen.
Shed for me. Wash knows. You just know what that means. Well, with everything that's going on, can't do this. And the news tells us it's not getting any better. And we look around at the rioting and everything that's going on, and they say it's not getting any better. I'm here to tell you today that it is going to get better. Do you know why? Because this is not our home. We're just passing through. And we have to suffer just a little while, but But the Bible says, don't be surprised by the fiery trials that are there to test you. Jesus said, I've overcome the world. We're in it. We're not of it. Now, that doesn't mean we don't face everything that's going on with everything that's going on down here. It doesn't mean we're not affected by it. Many of you may have had coronavirus. Many of you know loved ones that did or currently have it. It's a real thing. But we've been traveling a good bit in the last couple months, and I see a lot of churches that it's an odd feeling if you've never stood in a place like this and look around and see everybody wearing masks. It's a little unnerving sometimes. But God did not give us the spirit of fear. Amen? I'm going to say that again. I didn't hear you on this side. God did not give us the spirit of fear. Amen? Amen. But I believe God gave us common sense. Amen? Everybody got in on that one. But if common sense were common, there'd be a lot more of it. Would you agree with that? So I think we just have to do the things that we're supposed to do. And this world's not our home. I can't get that message out of my head. This world is not our home. So if you face some things this year, in the last couple of years, if you face some things this morning, I'm here to tell you today, this world is not our home. Amen. And I hope you're looking forward to the day. To the man on the brink of despair, are you living like nobody cares? To the woman at the well of regret, searching for love that you haven't found yet. You just can't forget, but hold on, be strong, it won't be long till we fly away. You will know joy, I pray. God will rain down sweet praise until we fly away. Disillusion from innocence lost, nursing the wounds from the battles you've fought. But there is still hope at the foot of the cross. So hold on, be strong, it won't be long till we to that day, church. Amen. Amen. Can I talk to you for just a minute? I know I've been talking a lot, but I want to talk a little bit more. I want you to know a little about me. When Stephanie and I decided we were going to do this, we want to do it as a family and she travels with me. Our youngest daughter goes with us sometimes, and she sings and does everything. We have lots of musicians and all that, but we want to be a family. And I've always said, I don't care anything about being famous. I don't need fans all over the country. I don't need my name up in lights and all that. But what we do want are friends. And I feel like if we're friends, that we need to know some things about each other. So I want to talk with you for just a few minutes about how God has worked in my life and the things that he has done and continues to do. And I know we have some smaller ones, so everything in my testimony is rated G. But parents, you'll understand things that I'm saying. You know, it's been said that the wealthiest pieces of land are the diamond fields in Africa, the diamond mines and the oil fields in Iraq. Those are the wealthiest pieces of land. I would disagree with that. I would say that the wealthiest piece of land you probably passed on your way in this morning, and it's called a cemetery. And I want to explain that to you. Under that ground out there, under all that dirt, are buried dreams, goals, hopes, desires. Under all that ground were ideas for businesses that were never started. Goals for a book to be written, a sermon to be preached, a song to be sung that never happened. And I'm curious as to why. And I almost became one of those stories, and I want to tell you about that this morning. When I was in the fourth grade, I was a fat kid. I mean, I was the chunky, chunky kid. And I learned really quick that if I made fun of me, then you couldn't. If I told the jokes, there was nothing for you to laugh about. That's a hard way to live for a 10-year-old. It's a hard way to live for anybody, making fun of yourself. But that's how I survived every day. And my fourth grade teacher was the meanest lady on the face of the planet. I'm convinced that she was about 112 then. She was long past retirement age. She was one of those teachers that when you got into trouble, she made you stand in the back of the room with encyclopedias in your hands. And if your arm started to droop a little bit, she would put a second encyclopedia in your hand. She was one of those teachers that would draw a circle on the chalkboard, and you had to put your nose in the circle and stand there in the front of the room. Just mean. Our class went on a three-day overnight field trip to Rock Eagle, if any of you know where that is, those campgrounds. And my family couldn't afford it. We didn't get to go, and so I stayed back. And the next week, they came back, and they were talking about the trip. And there was another little boy in my class. He was kind of chunky as well. His name was Jackie. And my teacher never called me by my first name. She always called me Harry. She said, "Harry, it's a good thing you didn't go on this trip with us." And I said, "Why?" And she said, "Between you and Jackie, there wouldn't have been any water left in that pool." Well, that hurt my heart. We lived across the street from the school, and I knew enough to march over and tell my mother what had been said. I wasn't quite old enough to know what a snowball effect was. My mother marched herself across that street and gave that principal an earful, who then went and gave the teacher The next morning, I was called out into the hallway, and this was the apology that I received. "Harry, I don't think I said anything to hurt your feelings, but if I did, I'm sorry." That was my apology. Several more things happened throughout the year. I'll spare you those details. But at the end of the year, the one person that should have been feeding into me, the one person that should have been saying, "Be whatever you want to be. Chase your dreams. Follow those dreams. You want to be an astronaut? Be an astronaut. You can do anything you set your mind to." Those are the things that I should have been hearing. My teacher looked me in the eye in front of the entire classroom and said, "Harry, you'll never make anything out of yourself." And I carried those words with me for 30 plus years. So what I heard from that was, "It's your fault. You're not going to do anything, and it's your fault." In the fifth grade, I experienced some things by the hand of a family friend that no child should ever experience. You with me, parents? But what I heard was, "This is your fault." I knew it was wrong, but I heard, "This is your fault." So never told anybody, never said anything about it. The problem with that is I was convinced that that's how boyfriend-girlfriend relationships were supposed to work. And that was difficult, proved very difficult. Got into sixth grade band, started playing the trumpet, and I told you I'd already been singing, so I was in the choir and things, and went to a performing arts high school, marched in a thing called drum and bugle corps, and I slimmed way down. I came back to high school skinny, and sun-bleached hair, and these blue eyes, and I thought, okay, well, here I am. I'm not the chunky kid anymore. Everybody seems to like me now. Got into band, I got into performing arts, I worked at Six Flags, did shows, and I thought, okay, entertainment is going to be my thing. Because of that, I didn't focus much on my schoolwork. I got accepted to several schools that offered me full rides, but I couldn't get in because of my grades. So I found a school in Jacksonville, Alabama, that said, as long as you take the SAT, we're good, it doesn't matter what your score is, but they put me in all these remedial classes, you know. So I thought, well, I'm here. I'm in college. I'm on a scholarship. I was one of those trumpet players that stood out in front of the band screaming, playing all those high notes. And I thought, yes, I'm here. And then 2 years into college, I had to drop out because getting married was the right thing to do. You with me, parents? So I was married for 16 years. So when I dropped out of college, I heard those words again. You're never going to make anything out of yourself. When I was delivering produce as a trumpet player and a singer and an entertainer and a performer and all this, I heard you're never going to make anything out of yourself. When I stepped into a relationship outside of my marriage, I heard you're never going to make anything out of yourself. When my divorce happened, you're never going to make anything out of yourself. My kids were moved away. Their mom moved 6 hours away. And I heard you're never going to make anything out of yourself. Nobody even wants you anymore. So it was Mother's Day. This year will be 9 years. I was had just signed my mom's card and put her gift together and everything and gotten a shower and was headed over to see her. And my phone rang and it was my dad. And when I picked the phone up, he was screaming hysterically. Couldn't make out any words. And the next voice I heard was that of the paramedic. And here's exactly what he said. Hey, I'm sorry to tell you, but your mother just died. And I didn't hear that quite right. So I asked again, and he said the exact same words. And I thought, well, Dad, she had broken her ankle in December before that. She had outpatient surgery. Something wasn't healing right, so they wanted to go in and take all those plates out. The bone had healed. Everything was good. She had outpatient surgery on her ankle on Friday. Sunday morning, she just didn't wake up. So I thought, well, maybe Dad tried to take her to church and they've had a wreck. I said, do I come to the hospital? And the paramedic said, no, your dad probably just needs you to come to your house. I live 45 minutes from them. It took me 15 minutes to get there. And I'll never forget that scene with all the emergency vehicles and the police and having to make a phone call to the funeral home. I'll never forget that. But when the craziness settled down a little bit and I was sitting on the front porch by myself, I didn't hear, you'll never make anything out of yourself again. I didn't hear that. I didn't hear, it's all your fault. I didn't hear those. The words I heard then were, you're done. It's over. You see, my mother was my biggest cheerleader. No matter what I did in life, no matter where I went wrong, my mother loved me unconditionally, and I knew it. So I started hearing things, you'll never make any, I mean, you're done. Your biggest cheerleader's gone. Nobody cares for you. Nobody wants you. So there's a spot just outside of Dallas, Georgia, this big hill that comes around, and there's a curve. And right there in that curve is a big telephone pole and an oak tree, side by side. And I decided that that would be my way out of this world. And oddly enough, I talked to God about that and said, I don't want anybody else to be hurt. So if there's ever oncoming traffic, I'll keep my hands on the wheel. But if it's ever an empty street, I'm just going to let go and whatever happens, happens. To this day, folks, to this day, almost 9 years, every time we travel down that road, there is always oncoming traffic. It may just be one car, but there's always oncoming traffic. And that's why I'm telling you that even 9 years, when I went through a lot of depression with that, and 9 years later, God is still showing me that he's in charge. He's in control of how my life works. So let's come back to the cemetery for just a second. Dreams, goals, businesses, songs, sermons, books, all of this undone. I would venture a guess because somebody said, you're not good enough. That's a horrible idea. It'll never work. There's somebody better than you. You can't do this. I imagine that's why those are there. I don't want to be one of those stories. The fact that you woke up this morning proves that God has a purpose for your life, and I don't want you to be one of those stories. I don't care if you're 9, 90, 109. If you wake up, God has a purpose for your life. Mark, did you drove a car in this morning? No horses? You didn't come in on a horse? So how fast does the speedometer say your car will go? 140. Got a nice car, church. 140. So if I walked out to your car right now, Mark, and I walked around and I looked at it, kicked its tires, and I said, you know what? You are the ugliest thing I have ever seen. Does that mean it won't go 140? No. What if I go out and say, I don't like the color that's on your car? No, does that mean it won't go? Nope. How about if I look at the car and say, you are an oversized, ugly mess? Does that mean it won't go 140? No. It will do that because the manufacturer of that car wrote a catalog that said, I've given this car all that it needs, all the electrical, fire, torque, power, everything it needs to perform at its optimal. Not asking you to test it, I'm asking you to trust me and drive the car, right? I have good news for you, church. Our manufacturer also wrote a catalog. And he said, I formed you in your mother's womb, in the secret places. And he said, all the days of your life were planned. Did you get that? All the days of your life were planned before one of them ever came to be. That means God has given you all the power that you need to fulfill the purpose he has for your life. If I take an apple seed and lay it out there on the tile, and then we don't touch it for 50 years, Pastor, what happens to it? Nothing, right? It just dries up because that's not its purpose. But if we plant that seed and we give it some water and we give it some sunlight, it's going to sprout and it's going to grow into this huge apple tree. But the cool thing about it, every apple that will ever come from that tree is inside that seed. Everything that tree will ever need is inside that seed. Everything you will ever need, God has already placed inside of you. And he said he's faithful. He who began a good work in you, right, is faithful to see it to completion. So whatever those dreams are, whatever those hopes and those goals, do them. Are you depressed? Maybe. I was. Needed medication for it. Thank God I'm off that now. Kevin, do you still have depressed days? Ask this lady here. There are days I don't want to get out of bed, but I know that there's a God who planned all of my days. So sometimes there's a mountain in our way. Would you agree with that? You ever heard that old song, God, please don't move the mountain. Just give me strength to climb. Have you ever thought that maybe there's a mountain in your way for a reason? I see those things that people put on Facebook, and they said, if God seems silent in your life, remember that the teacher is always quiet during a test. So when you hear God, or you can't see his voice, his plan, you can't hear that voice, you can always trust that his hand is guiding you. So if there's a mountain in your way, it's a lesson. Sometimes it takes that in our lives for us to gain our focus back to God. Amen. I want to do this song for you now. It talks about a mountain in our way and the struggles that we have through this life. I hope you enjoy this song.
faced a mountain that I've never faced before. That's why I'm calling on you, Lord. I know it's been a while, but Lord, please hear my prayer. I need you like I never have before. Sometimes it takes a mountain. Sometimes a troubled sea. Sometimes it takes a desert to get a hold of me. Your love is so much stronger. Forgive me, Jesus, I thought I could control whatever life would throw my way. But this I will admit has brought me to my knees. I need you, Lord, and I'm not ashamed. Sometimes
as I hear Kevin's story, and I can't say that I can relate to a lot of what he had to deal with, but as I hear him and hear his God's interaction in his life, and I think about the things that many of us do deal with on a on what seems like nowadays a daily basis, on a weekly basis, I think about, my mind went to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, where it said that God will confirm you to the end. And then verse 9 begins by simply saying three words: God is faithful. And then I we just got finished talking about the end times and what was going to go on in the end. And one fact that I really didn't hammer on, but really makes a whole lot of sense right now. In the end, when Jesus comes back, and if you remember, at the Battle of Armageddon, we put it lightly to say that he was going to come and kick behind. It says that when he shows up, he's got a couple of names on him. And of all the names, of all the things that could have been said about Jesus, it simply says the names that he comes riding on a horse with are faithful and true. And I don't know what everybody in here deals with. I know some. But what you need to know, whatever it is that you deal with, God is faithful. Whatever you need, God is faithful. And it might be some material need that you have. It might be a relational need that you have. It might be a spiritual need that you have. You may need salvation here today and think that there's no way that that could be offered to you because of all the things that you've done in your past. I mean, who are you to even ask for it? Let me just tell you, if God promised it to you, if you call upon him, he's faithful. If he promises to meet your needs, he is faithful. If he promises to be there for you, he is faithful. You simply must call upon him and trust him. And sometimes when we're in our darkest valley and we're down and things begin to feel hopeless, that's the thing that seems to elude us the most. And that is to simply trust that someone is there. But understand what we find all the time. And maybe I really wasn't even thinking about it until I was sitting over here. Maybe that's a message I need to preach, is the faithfulness of God in all things. And if you would like help, if you would like to talk with someone about that, I hope that you will contact us in the church office. I'll be around here this morning for those of you who are here. If you're watching online, you can certainly contact us in the church office and we'll get back with you as soon as possible. But we'd like to be able to talk with you and walk with you through those difficulties so that we can encourage you in God's faithfulness if you'll but call upon him. Let's go to God in prayer now. Lord, I pray because there are so many needs in here, some that I know, some that I don't know, many, many that I don't know about, and certainly many more in the homes of those who are watching with us online. And God, sometimes we don't know where to turn, and we hear some stories that blow our minds, and then we hear some stories that they don't seem to be that outrageous to those who are outside, but those who are telling them, it could be heart-rendering. And God, I thank you that you are faithful in all things, and that whatever someone's need is, that they can call upon you. We thank you that we don't have to walk through this life alone. We don't have to walk through this life hopelessly. But knowing you, that there is hope in this life, and there is certainly hope in the life to come. And God, I pray especially for that individual who recognizes that there is some need that is beyond themselves, a need that they can't supply on their own, that maybe they have tried, and they've tried in their works, they've tried in church, they've tried in religion, but it really hasn't, nothing seems to have worked. I pray that they would call upon you today and find Jesus in a relationship and find the void filled as only you can. God, I thank you for the testimony that we've heard today and the faithfulness that you've shown in his life. And may that be an example to all of us as well. So we thank you for our time together, and we pray that you've been pleased as we've worshiped you. And Lord, I pray that it would be a strengthening tool for us as we leave here. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, y'all want to hear at least one more thing out of Kevin, I trust. Now, as soon as this is over with, he didn't ask me to say this, but I wanted to do want to tell you, we will be taking up a love offering. We've spoken to that before. There's going to be somebody at both these entrances here, and so I encourage you to give to that. But also, he's going to have a product table at the back that he'll tell you a little bit about, and I hope that you'll support him in getting some of that to take home with you as well. So, Kevin, you appreciate all you've done so far, and one more, at least one more. Appreciate it.
Well, I was going to ask if it was okay if I sang another one. The pastor gave me permission. So. We do have a table out front. There's several CDs on it. I think the Christmas CD is even still there. So if you're missing Christmas time and you want to hear some of those are out there. My daughter, Natalie, sings. She has a little three-song demo out there. Have you heard the song You Say by Lauren Daigle? You might know that song. Natalie recorded that. And once you hear Natalie do it, you won't want to hear Lauren do it anymore. She's that good. She's our retirement plan. I should have brought her with us today. My very first CD was over 10 years ago in Nashville, and it was all brand new songs by a brand new artist, so I still have most of those CDs available. Nobody knew me, and they didn't know the songs, but they're all about holding on to hope and the promises of God, so talk with you about that one. There's one called By Request. It's a lot of the Gaither songs, those type of songs, and places I would go, people would say, you should do this song, you should do this one, you should. So I finally made a list and recorded those songs, and then A New Day is out there. The song I'm about to do is on that CD. And our newest one called Sometimes It Takes a Mountain, which is a song that I just did. Chainbreaker is on there. Amazing Grace is on there as well. Just a lot of great songs. There's a couple of t-shirts out there. My favorite is Jesus Loves This Hot Mess. And then there's another called Created with a Purpose that just goes along with my testimony. There's some bracelets and things like that. The CDs are $10 each. You do 4 for $30. That's better than Walmart. That's a better deal than Walmart. 4 for $30. If you have one of those new cars that doesn't have a CD player in it, I have a card out there for a digital download. You can go to our website and put in that code, and you can download all that music to your computer, and then put that wherever you need it. We're also on Spotify and Apple Music and iTunes. So if you guys want to go there. The most important thing, though, to me that's on the table, and I know you're hungry, I'm going to let you go, there's some green and orange cards back there, and those are referral places. If you know someone in a church that can make a decision to bring me in to share our ministry, if you could give me their name and number, we would appreciate that. Brother Mark took a big risk on us because he didn't know me, didn't know anything about me, and when we call churches, my name is not recognized, so it's hard for churches. So if I can call and say, this person said I should give you a call, sometimes that's easier. The last thing I'll say, when you visit the website, there's lots of pictures and videos and things like that. But if through my testimony this morning, or if anything struck a chord with you, if you've experienced some things like that in your life and you need somebody to talk to, but if it's you don't feel comfortable talking to church staff or anything like that, Stephanie and I are both licensed counselors. We have our master's degree in counseling, and we do that when we're not doing music. There's a link on my website that just says counseling, and it will take you to our counseling website. Everything we do is on the phone right now because COVID won't allow us to meet in person. So if you would like to set up something just to talk with people, we'd love to hear from you on that. Okay? Can I do one more song for you? Just one. All right. For 400 years, God was silent, and they waited for a night. They were looking for that one event to happen, the birth of the Messiah, and it happened. And then Jesus lived a perfect, sinless life and was crucified on a cross for you and for me. And then he went back to be with his Father. And he said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go, I'm coming back to receive you unto myself. And that's the event that we're looking for today. I hope your eyes are open, and I hope you're ready to go. Thank you.
I see prophecies fulfilled.